Once upon a time, in a small town in Mesopotamia, there lived a potter and his innovative and enterprising young daughter. Actually, this was around 4000 BC, when people could already weave baskets and cloth, sew with needles, even play the flute. But our young potter, who had great ambitions of growing her business, decided to do something different. She set up a round rotating stone which could be spun to make pots. She had successfully invented the wheel, and the world will never be the same again. Why am I telling you that story? Because we are now in the midst of a very similar transformation driven by artificial intelligence, and the world of tomorrow is going to be completely different from the world of yesterday. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Well, wherever you look, there's certainly no dearth of information and opinions on AI. But the three aspects of this topic that I'm going to cover today are: what exactly is AI, and why are we suddenly talking so much about it? Will it help or harm? And most importantly, what can we do about it? Okay? Right, so for the first part, simply put, artificial intelligence is the ability of a machine to simulate human intelligence. Now, traditionally, computers needed to be programmed, that is, given explicit step-by-step instructions to follow. So those of you who've coded know what this involves. Those of you who haven't, if you've ever set the temperature or the spin speed on a smart washing machine, you've effectively programmed a computer. Now, over time, with complex rules and logic, this gave rise to narrow AI, where machines could perform specific functions like being voice assistants or robot vacuum cleaners. However, there are some tasks which are very easy for human beings to do, but surprisingly difficult to write rules for. Classic example, a two-year-old will instinctively tell you whether a picture is that of a cat. But for a computer, this is a very hard problem. And if I were to ask you to explain why is this a cat and nothing else, you would struggle too. Right? So scientists changed the approach from giving the computer explicit rules to letting the computer figure them out for itself. And this is machine learning, a branch of AI where, just like a two-year-old learns from all the information they come across, machines are fed huge amounts of data called training data, which they learn from, and then apply that learning to other tasks. So think of how your phone autocorrects when you're texting, or Netflix learns that if you've secretly binged watched Twilight, maybe you'll like some vampire romances again. One branch of this was inspired by human biology. The brain was still very much the learning ideal. So scientists created electrical circuits which mimicked the architecture and function of neurons in the human brains and the connections between them. The brain, though, has 86 billion neurons and 100 trillion connections. So what did they do? They stacked up many, many layers of interconnected neurons to form deep neural networks. This gave rise to deep learning, which enables computers to perform even more complex functions like driving cars or recognizing speech or describing images. With me so far? All good? Excellent. Because now we come to the best part. As computers got more and more brain-like, it has brought us to today. In an evolution of AI called generative AI, this is where the thinking is done by massive models trained on huge neural networks using internet-scale data. These models now have the capability of tackling completely new and unseen situations and generating answers to questions they've never even been trained on. The way they do this is by finding and predicting the word or the image that comes closest to the question that they're being asked. The name generative comes from this new ability of generating new content, and people are now using GenAI models to create art and poetry and stories and images and music and movies and so much more. New applications are being found as we speak. Isn't that amazing? It's really, really cool. It's almost as amazing as our friends in Mesopotamia realizing that they could use a wheel on a chariot. But 300 years after our potter friend used it in her workshop. AI is like that. It's been around for years and years. We've been using it for years and years. So when you ask Google Maps for the quickest route, or when Amazon tells you what they think you should buy next, that's all AI, and it has been for a long time. So why are we suddenly talking so much about it? Why are we reading about AI in the Evening Standard, and why did you all stop getting English essay assignments for homework in January? The reason is what we human beings think of as intelligence. You see, we have a very inherent tendency to attribute intelligence to the ability to communicate, to articulate, and to conduct conversations. So what changed was that in November 2022, a company called OpenAI, which builds the large models that we spoke about before, they put an interface on top of a large language model called Generative Pre-trained Transformer, or GPT. That allowed people to chat with the model and hold conversations. So now, rather than only a few specialist computer scientists who understood computer language being able to interact with these models, everyone could. Raise your hands if you've spoken to ChatGPT or used it before. Anyone? Oh, wow, I'm so impressed. That's a lot of you. Excellent. And did you find the answer smart? Did you find the model impressive? Yes? See, and that is the second reason why we're finding this so smart. Because the answers we get make sense to us, AI seems smarter, and we fear what it could end up doing. Now, the reason all of these models are smart or sound smart to us is because we're in a perfect storm of all the things that make AI models really powerful computationally. And these are the processing power of computers and the size of the models, the amount of data available to train these models, and memory. And all three of these are growing at such a rapid pace that it's hard to comprehend. I remember when I was a child growing up back in India, my father had coded the entire sales and inventory management system for his motorcycle workshop from scratch using COBOL. And I remember thinking how incredibly cool that was. But more so, I was fascinated by these small little multicolored floppy disks which were in a plastic box that I was not even allowed to touch. I can see from your faces, half of you have never even seen these before, but each of them could hold less memory than is needed for a single selfie. Speaking of processing power, the iPhone 12, which is already outdated, was 5,000 times faster than a supercomputer from 1985, which in itself was more than 150,000 times faster than the guidance computer in Apollo 11, which put a man on the moon. Today's most advanced AI models use 5 billion times the computational power of the most cutting-edge models from just a decade ago. Can you imagine? No wonder ChatGPT sounds smart to us. In fact, it had better be, right? However, on the flip side, while these models perform really impressively on tasks involving language, they are not that great at generating new mathematical understanding. Calculations, once told what to do, yes. But coming up with new theorems, not really. You see, we humans learn and we apply our acquired knowledge in a combination with reasoning, ethics, and understanding. And it is still a uniquely human trait to deal with real-world scenarios which require a much more holistic, a much more logical and rational approach. And so we're still a long way off from machines being smarter than human beings. But, and there is a but. That scenario is not outside the realms of possibility. What happens when AI starts building AI? And if it were to happen, would that superintelligence be benign or malicious? The simple answer is nobody knows. We don't know because we don't really understand how these mega models work. And so we cannot say whether they're intelligent or self-aware or benign or not. They do offer new answers which are arguably intelligent, but the downside is those answers are very difficult to explain. Understanding why a model came up with a certain output or how it arrived at that output will take scientists years and years, and obviously those models will have turned into something entirely different by then. And that is why it is so crucial to understand the limitations, the risks, and the dangers of AI. We've already started coming across concerns around things like hallucinations, where the model just fabricates something, or copyright infringement, or bias. There's a famous example of when asked to generate images of Barbies from different countries around the world, AI gave the Somalian one a gun. And there are many such examples. We are literally just scratching the surface of AI and what it is capable of. The one good thing, and a really powerful one, is the fact that the agency to determine the use of AI sits with human beings, at least for now. It is up to us to choose whether we use it for good applications, like medical diagnosis, or drug discovery, or predicting and preventing natural disasters, or analyzing climate data for sustainability, or promoting financial inclusion, and so much more. But on the flip side, exactly the same technology could be used for evil, for generating unrest through deepfake creation, for promoting cyber attacks, for surveillance, for even more malicious uses like autonomous weapons or using machines for bad deeds. Entire governments and regulators and academia are focused on regulating AI in an effort to make it safer. But we don't know whether that will be timely or whether that will be enough. And this is where I say something really controversial. Whether AI is good or bad is actually besides the point. How many of you have surfed before? You have? Adventurous people, very nice. Think of how it feels when you're sitting astride your surfboard, having paddled in, watching this small wave approaching you. That wave is getting bigger and bigger. It is picking up speed as it comes closer. And whether you want it to or not, it is going to get to you. The only choice you have is whether you pop up on your surfboard to ride it or whether you let it wipe you out. AI is like that. Whether we like it to or not, it is taking over the world, and there is no fence for us to sit on. So, how do we not get drowned out? And how do we actually ride that AI wave? Any thoughts? Well, you're in luck, because I'm going to give you three tenets to put you in the best possible position to do exactly that. First, jump onto the bandwagon. What do I mean by that? The year is 1928. The claimant to making and selling the first American gasoline-powered car is one Alexander Winton, who runs a bicycle plant in Cleveland. Now, Alexander wants to build a vehicle that keeps moving without requiring pedaling. So he works on it, and he comes up with the automobile. His banker calls him up and says, "You're crazy if you think that fool contraption you've been wasting your time on will ever displace a horse." Remember when the internet first became accessible to the public, or mobile phones first got popular? Did we all just sit around procrastinating and weighing the pros and cons endlessly and fearing all the worst that could happen? And even if we had, the world was lapping it up, and eventually all of us had to catch up. Which is not to say that no bad things will come out of AI. They almost certainly will. Its usage definitely does require control. But how can we hope to avoid those dangers and control the usage unless we have the required familiarity with the technology and we have the expertise to do that controlling? Which brings me to the second point. Use AI in your daily lives. We all know the best way of mastering a language is to start speaking it and practice it every day, right? So I want each of you to do this. Think of one task which you do routinely, which takes up your time, that you much rather didn't. One mental task which you'd love to automate. It could be anything. It could be creating a blog outline, or sending out birthday party invites, or setting homework assignments, or creating revision flashcards, anything. Everybody got one? Now, I want you to pledge to go home and research the AI tools that will make this task easier for you. There are hundreds of apps and tools and solutions out there for all the use cases that I mentioned and much more. So go out there, try them out, see what works, see what helps, see what doesn't. And then repeat the process. Make AI a part of your daily life. Start speaking the language. And at each point, register what you're learning, what you're liking, what is not working, what you don't like, what you don't agree with, and then start asking the right questions. Which brings me to the final point. Never stop questioning. If there's one thing from all of this that I want you to take away, one idea that I want you to remember, it is this. Never stop questioning. As AI becomes smarter and smarter at giving us answers, the one thing that it's still limited on is its ability to ask questions. And we're talking about basic questions like helping its learning, like clarifying what an image is, for example. The questions that really matter are the questions that have never been asked before, which is still something just a human brain can do. So as AI becomes part of our daily lives, we need to be asking the right questions. We need to ask to learn and understand. How does this work? What does this mean? Be skeptical of the outputs that you get and the answers that you get from AI. Do they make sense? Does anything that Aditi's just said make sense? Question it all. As you become users and designers and developers of AI, you'll need to ask, how do I make this better? How do I make this safer? What aspects need to be regulated? How can I reduce the climate impact of AI? Should we stop training models? Why? How can I stop AI from falling into the wrong hands? Who decides which hands are wrong? And finally, as you start controlling the technology, ask, how can AI help me be all I can be? How can I use it to make the world all that it can be? And that is what I'm going to end on. AI is an immensely powerful new technology that is changing the world and will continue to do so in ways we cannot even imagine. Our only hope in making this evolution successful and beneficial is if we understand the technology, embrace it, and learn to control it. And never stop questioning. Thank you for listening.